First anniversary of June 3rd disaster marked with remembrance service.
Seven burned to death at Asante Mampo. You're welcome to the news on GBC24 and GTV. This is News Hour. My name is Shirley Annan.
Good evening. I'm Seoko Kwakutre, and you are welcome. A remembrance church service for victims of last year's June 3rd disaster was held in Accra today with President John Mahama and many government functionaries in attendance. A combined flood and fire disaster around the Goyle filling station at the Kwame Nkrumah Circle in Accra killed about 160 people last year. Others who survived the ordeal got badly injured. It was a tragedy many Ghanaians are yet to overcome. Napoleon Atu Kito was at the remembrance ceremony and now reports.
The Ernest Bruce Memorial Methodist Church was the venue for the memorial service for the victims of last year's June 3rd disaster. 154 bodies were retrieved from the rubble, most of them in a charred state, after they had succumbed to a Goyle filling station in Feno at the time it was raining heavily in the night. Those who were taking protection from the rain at the fuel depot and nearby places became the unfortunate victims of a flooding which had restricted their movement, only to be engulfed by fire. As the victims were consumed by the twin disasters, many knew next to nothing about the scale of the tragedy until the dust settled. It was then the nation began to count the cost and embark on a survey in the hope of salvaging something. President John Mahama was on the scene of the tragedy the next day and gave instructions for the offer of emergency medication to survivors, most of whom had burns, while compensations were made after full assessment of situation. The first anniversary church service in Accra was well attended by the authorities and victims' families. The president did not speak, but his presence spoke volumes of the extent of pain the nation has had to endure as a result of the incident. The mayor of Accra, Mr. Alfred Oko Vanderpoy, indicated that measures were being taken to address the drainage problem which causes flooding.
May we continue our resolve that together we will all work to avert another June 3rd. May the Lord bless us as we worship today to his glory and to his honor.
As the congregation dispersed from the church auditorium, President John Mahama made a dash at some of the victims and shook hands with them. He then moved to the Goyle filling station to lay a wreath for the victims on behalf of government and the people of Ghana. The disaster spot is yet to see a comprehensive cleanup as remnants of the incident are still visible. Napoleon Atukitu reporting.
Now, it occurred exactly a year ago, but events of June 3 are still fresh in the minds of many Ghanaians. Some are yet to overcome their grief, while many still are yet to recover from their losses. As the country remembers one of the darkest days in its history, the belief of many is that such a tragedy does not recur.
Only a year ago, Accra, precisely the Kwame Nkrumah Circle, was hit by a flood and fire disaster that claimed more than 150 lives. When the news team visited the disaster site, people had gathered there watching a caricature mounted at the site to depict what happened on that dark day. The artist, Mr. Faisal Dauda, threw more light on the message he wants to send across through the artwork.
Everybody is learning a lesson from it, because the first lesson you learn, you could see a tall man standing. The man signifies the fire serviceman who came in to rescue people from the flood and the fire. And the man is sharing tears. The tears that the man is sharing, that tells you that is the darkest tears of Mother Ghana. That's why I use black polythene to signify the tears. From the tears, you could see it is dropping on the dead body of a woman. The woman is a pregnant woman. She has been flooded and burnt to that stage. So the fire serviceman has carried her. So you could see how sorrowful it is. So downward, you could also see that there is a woman holding a baby. She has been flooded up to today. They didn't discover her. And there is another one, some babies who has been burnt in the water. And I use the same plastic to create a water scene, which tells you this is the flood. And I use plastic bottles to choke them. It tells you that the plastic bottle you seems that is nothing. This is how you throw it on the street. It's contributed to this that disaster that we witnessed.
Pictures of those who died in the disaster, as well as those of the survivors, have also been posted at vantage points within the disaster site. They include pictures of some carpet sellers who used to sell around the oil filling station. Drivers and 32-year-old Roberta Na Ayelekwe and her 1-year-old daughter. Kojo Simon lost 3 of his friends in the disaster, and he tells us that he has yet to come to terms with the loss.
Some of started bare 4 more in a coffin bare 10 hours. That room, you know, but bare 7 more. Now came the transfer car, be back inside your own. You must have one cast in Babananka. Yakope be there at some because you need to know to what yes, I can't be answering at Emma. Tell 50 cents. No, on a fair car, and that is once where a chairman to look up so where the coom to mumping for the head of coom. To me, one who said they are what Jimmy there, some coming up for we watch it all. Now, yes, I'm a coin to be corner. We don't have any bear 1 hour. No, because me master no na dada no mu na wu. Te ma na mi su sa ma bi jan na me so me ko na me chi ba mi enu. E wa na o ji bala bala. Te mi se bi o no so wa ide. Wa kan ho. Te cha mi bu se no mka so won de o kofi. Ba mi na mi hu e mi wa se te ma na e jan na me hu de ya. Mi fi ya ko ya so mi su si ye.
Miss Comfort Mensah says she is still haunted by what she witnessed on that day.
E no kwasem ni. Sa jun te de no de. Imagine I chase a salmon, and quite I am sure me told me so. Mammy Timata going to me 2 minutes car, a bass circle. Me do a canoe cross road, no, to me far for frock or seat at my station car. Now, my auntie flew or by. Now, no, couldn't yam 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 Now, some say, dear, if you say a woman, who be that? Everything is our embassies are bringing, they be a general woman. Now, me bomb pie pass on the moment, say, a rather informal currency a year.
Another victim, Auntie Mary, who spoke to us off camera, said she lost 2 family members in the disaster, and their family house was shared a wall with the oil filling station at the Kwame Nkrumah Circle was also raised by the fire. Auntie Mary said her family has since not received any compensation.
In our continuing coverage of June 3rd Memorial, we now cross over to the Nkrumah Interchange, where the fire broke out, leaving hundreds dead. Abdulhai Mumin and Salikem Akolachapolu are standing by with the latest update.
Thank you very much, Soyoko. Maybe even before I proceed to tell you what I have been observing since I arrived here this evening, it's important that probably I take you through a bit of the history, the reasons behind which we are here today. Where we are can conveniently be described as Ground Zero. This is where exactly a year ago, just at about the same hour, this time that I'm speaking, last year, June 3rd, 2015, a large, loud blast was heard from these very grounds. And following that loud blast was the loss of lives of more than 150 people. That incident left many families devastated because breadwinners were lost and many children have been orphaned. Many wives have been widowed and many husbands have been left wifeless even as we speak. And today a ceremony was held at these very grounds to commemorate the event. And it wasn't just this event. On that same day, following the torrential rains, people lost their lives following the floods that devastated almost the whole of Accra. And following that flash again, you will recall that there was a massive campaign for fuel stations not to be sited along residential areas and along areas where many people were commuting and so on and so forth. And following that also was the dredging of the Kole Lagoon, which was believed to be one of the major causes of the floods of last year. Again, you recall that many homes were demolished, especially around the old Fadama area, where people believed that authorities believed at the time that some people had constructed their residences along the waterways, and that prevented the water from flowing into the lagoon and probably also into the sea, and that could have led to the floods, which also led to the blast that happened here on that same day. And I've been here since evening, and this morning there was a ceremony, and to my left hand side a poster was raised that has the names of almost all those who lost their lives. A few people I've already spoken to here this evening are not very happy because they believe that they also lost their family members right here on this very spot, yet their names cannot be found on that list, and that is a matter of concern to some of the people who are gathered here this evening. Many of them are also saying that they have just come to remind themselves of what could happen to any of us at any time, because many of those who were caught in the blast were people who were just shelter seekers. They had just come to the site to seek shelter because it was raining. And today, coincidentally, there was another rain, except for the fact that as we speak the rains are not falling, and some of the cars that were parked on these grounds are still parked out there a year after the disaster. The cars are still over there, and even though they have been parked to one side, and you can see that this blast happened very close to the GCB towers near the Circle interchange, and this is where the blast actually happened, and many of the cars are still around here, as you can see them. And many people, passers-by, people who were affected directly or indirectly, people who lost their families and friends, have just been standing here. Some of them have been standing here for hours, and all they do is just to stand and observe. And I've been watching and observing some of them in a very, very pensive mood. I've just spotted a gentleman who is in a very pensive mood. I'll speak to him briefly. I spoke to, where's the gentleman who was in the, I think he's the one here. Okay, so he's decided not to speak to me right now, but I spotted so many of them. But again, I have this man here. He says that his friends were affected. And so you came here this evening exactly to do what?
I came to remember them, because right now, everything, I've lost a lot of my friends. So it's a coincidence that I came here to remember them.
How many friends? And first of all, when I came here, many of you were angry that some of the names of your friends were not here. Did you find the names of all your friends on that memorial list?
No, I haven't found it.
You didn't find the names?
I find some of them, but not all of them.
And do you remember that those friends who you believe that their name should have been here really died on this very spot?
Yes, I remember, because that day, I was coming here, but the school time that my wife told me that I shouldn't come because of the sake of my daughter, my little girl. That's why.
You were coming here before the blast or after the blast?
No, I was coming here because my wife stopped me that I shouldn't come here because my little girl was sick.
So you could have been part of what happened here. What would you have been coming here to do? Do you work around here?
Yes.
What do you do?
I do a lot of work. It's not a lot. One work I used to do. I used to sell spray. I had to do a lot of work, sell phone. At the same time, you see, life is going on. I'm a hustler, you see.
Right. So these friends of yours who passed away because of the blast that happened here, have you been in touch with their families?
Oh, yes, because some of them, they are from my hometown. I'm from Obokwe. and some of them are from Bomi. So after if we go to Easter to go and celebrate, I used to meet them so that we shake hands together and we eat together.
And how are those families coping with the loss of can you tell us?
They don't feel happy at all, because that my friends, and they are one helping their families.
Okay, all right, thank you very much, and we wish you all the best, and we hope that somebody's listening and that the names of those friends and lovers of yours whose names are missing on the list will be taken care of as well. We have another man here. So you say you also have a lot of your friends who passed away during that incident.
About this accident, a lot of my friends, I'm a Congolese, I'm working for the beach.
Right.
And always I used to day for this area because of Vienna City as a promoter, you know, and a lot of the girls, a lot of the friends where they are coming for Vienna City or the night, you know, say this place is the night places. So a lot of them pass.
So you are actually saying that you had a lot of friends who work with Vienna City or around the Vienna City area, and these are night workers, and you are from Congo, and so you
for the beach.
You work at the Badi Beach. Oh, okay. But again, I just want to understand your story. So most of the, you said some of the girls who were part of this accident are people you know.
Yeah, I know them because, you know, in the night, all of them, if in the night or any time, so they come for the beach, sad. So from the beach, they come back again, yes. So we supposed to deal with them, with the customer and a lot of the things. The same night, where the thing happens, I was infected for the Odona side too. The same problems.
Okay, so you and you are Congolese, and you knew some of these, and you are saying you knew some of the girls in particular. So some of these girls that you knew, were they all Ghanaians?
They are not all Ghanaians. Some Liberian girls there, some Ivory Coast girls there, and some Ghanaians too there.
So you are telling us that there were some Ivorian girls, some Liberian girls, as well as some Ghanaian girls as well that you knew. So these foreigners, do you have any clue whatsoever if their families are aware of what happened and that they could have been caught up in this web?
Especially, you know, we are meeting here like for Vienna City or for the beach, Princess One Love for the beach. But I don't know exactly their family and a lot of the things. Okay. But I know them as a friends and good friends. They are the customer where they are coming for the...
Thank you very much, and we wish you all the best. And if you get in touch with the family. And one, my colleague Selikem Akolache, for a very long time, when the disaster happened, was one of the people at the center of coverage of that disaster. And Selikem is right here with me. Selikem, it was a very emotional moment when we had to go out to cover the stories about people who were affected by this fire and by the flash of that day. And I remember that you were at the center of covering those who were actually traumatized by this. I know you've been speaking to some of the traumatized people. A year on, what have they been telling you?
Abdul, coming here today, I mean, even the feeling is still there. The chilling feeling of what happened here is still there. There are people here who would tell you that they could have been here. There are people who avoided using this route and were lucky not to have been caught up in this. As we got here, our crew had to find a place to park. And where did we park? We parked at a filling station. That alone brought back a certain chilling feeling that this could happen to anybody. But all these people who have been traumatized by this are still living with the trauma. The gap where we've not been able to psychologically help them out of it is what remains the concern. Some of them lost their livelihoods. They haven't gotten those jobs back. They're still struggling a year on. They will tell you that they have practically become beggars, and they are seeking assistance from family, but it's not been easy putting their lives back in order. And so people are still grappling with this. This is not over yet. And I think that as a nation, it's high time that we looked at these things from a psychosocial point of view, so that trauma can be reduced. There are people who still sleep and are still telling me that they hear screams in their sleep at night, Abdul.
It must be very worrying, especially a year on, if people still have these memories. And you, as a reporter, you are telling me that even yourself, having spoken to these people, it still brings shivers down your spine. But tell me, What lessons do you believe, and from a journalistic point of view, what lessons have we learnt from this incident? The cars are still parked here, and there are people who have raised concerns about the names of their family members not being on the list of those who are being remembered today.
Then when you look at the identification of persons, we still don't have a national way of identifying ourselves. The national identification system has been ongoing. There are still questions there. We have the voter ID cards, but we need to have a central system where we can all be identified so that it's easier to identify these people. That is why those people who have not been identified have not been identified as at now. Now, those are the gaps. Now, we are looking at drains. The Odo River is being dredged, yes. But what about the other drains that led to the Odo River? Look at the Nima River. We are told by the committee that the Nima gutter was too narrow. Nothing has been done to widen that drain. What happens next? Now, the attitude, it's still the same. We are still throwing rubbish out there. You go to Tetekwashi Interchange and you find that there are culverts that are open, filled with sand. And that was one major place where there was a lot of flooding. There were people stuck in traffic for hours, and we still have that situation. You find sand in the open culverts. These are lessons that we as a nation must learn so that we can actually heal from them. We've had three disasters. We're talking about the Malcolm disaster. We've had another one, and then this one has been the worst. Moving on, what are we doing as a nation?
Thank you very much, Selikem. Very important question. Moving on, what are we doing as a nation is the question that Selikem is asking, and that, I believe, is a question that many Ghanaians out there are asking. So, Yoko, back to you in the studio, and we'll bring you more updates as and when we have them.
Now, still staying on to the June 3 disaster, we're now bringing subsides and sounds from the disaster.
Unfortunately, a large number of people lost their lives. My condolences to the several who have lost relatives and the victims of the flood.
So all this side, they are just lucky that the water did not enter them well, like hours.
At a point, they thought he was dead because the water had carried him away.
Yet still to another star story, and seven people have been burnt to death at Rakesi, a suburb of Asante Mampon. They include the head of estate of the Buasi Municipal Hospital, Pastor Isaac Botwe, and his four children. A couple who were also on a visit were burnt beyond recognition.
The fire, which started at 3 a.m., burnt to death all seven occupants in the house. According to the landlady of the house, Amwakun, Pastor Isaac Botwe, his wife, and four children took occupancy of the three-bedroom apartment about a year ago. Pastor Botwe was later transferred from the Asante Mampo Municipal Hospital to the Obuasi Hospital as the head of estate of the hospital, leaving behind his wife and four children. He occasionally returned to visit both his family and his congregation at King Jesus Ministries at Mampon Tonsium. However, the family met their untimely death through fire accident. Firefighters came to the scene but could not help.
We realized that they were entrapped by the building because the structure of the building was in the form that it had only one entry and exit point, just one. As you consider burglary, you consider your safety too, because you can't consider only burglary and forget about your safety. You will plead for a burglar probably to take your property and spare your life, but you cannot plead with fire to take your property and spare your life.
Their bodies have been sent to the Mampon Hospital for autopsy. The cause of the fire is yet to be determined, and the police have started investigation.
Now to other stories. The presidential candidate of the People's National Convention, PNC, Dr. Edward Mahama, says a vote for the PNC is a vote for prosperity. On a visit to the Ghana Broadcasting Corporation, Dr. Mahama emphasized the need for Ghanaians to vote on issues rather than ethnicity, religion or creed. This will be his fifth attempt at the presidential seat of Ghana.
Dr. Edward Mahama led the PNC in the 1996 elections, 2000, 2004, and 2008. He lost to Hassan Ayariga in the 2012 elections. Dr. Edward Nasigiri Mahama, a gynecologist, is coming back to contest the 2016 poll and has started soliciting for votes in the run-up to the November polls. As part of his learning tour of institutions, Dr. Edward Mahama visited GBC to familiarize himself with their activities. He said GBC has evolved over the years since his last visit in 1996.
I have seen a lot of improvement and forward march in GBC, I must confess. Because 1996, when I first came and did a recording here, things were different from what they are. I'm happy to see that there is this upward mobility of GBC along with the rest of the country.
The elections is just some few months away, so why should Ghanaians vote for their PNC in November 7th?
If you go out there and you see the number of young people who have finished school and are unemployed, you have to feel sorry for yourself as a Ghanaian. I'm saying that even the power situation, electricity, you can come and examine it. I have a book where I have recorded power off, power on, power off, power on, since 2005. That's 11 years. I've been monitoring their performance. And I'm telling Ghanaians, I can fix the program.
He was optimistic of winning the general elections to resolve Ghana's developmental challenges and change the fortunes of Ghanaians for the better.
If you are 18 to 35, join my volunteer corps, because this is the group that is going to change Ghana from poverty, ignorance and disease into the prosperity that God himself endowed us with by making us the land of gold.
Dr. Mahama got 3.0% of the votes in the 1996 elections. In his second attempt at the presidency in 2000, he won 2.5% of the votes. He placed third out of four candidates during the 2004 elections, winning 1.9% of the votes. His last contest was in the 2008 presidential elections. For GBC24, Shelley Bewa reporting.
The ban on drumming and noise making has been lifted following the celebration of the Odadao, which officially marks the end of the ban. Degbese Manche Ni Aibonte led his elders perform rites signifying the lifting of the ban. Ni Aibonte appealed to the government to expedite action on the construction of the Salaga market, which started 18 years ago.
These are the Odadao drums. The drums are seen only once in a year, and this means a lot to the people of Gamashi. The ban on drumming and noise making is part of an annual ritual that precedes Homowo. The period of silence allows the traditional rulers to fast and pray for bumper harvest and for peace and national unity. The mantlock ban was imposed on 2nd May and lifted on the 2nd of June. On the occasion of Odadao, the traditional ruler beats the drums to signify the end of the ban on drumming and noise making. On display in this year's event was the rich tradition and culture of the seven clans of the Gamashi traditional area. Degbese Manche Ni Aibonte was happy the observance of this year's ban on drumming and noise making was successful. The Greater Accra Regional Minister Nilaye Afoteagu said government has a lot of respect for culture and tradition.
The soldier, the police, kamowa kanibi na nanya yoreda ya bia shikaya beni wa koma watu wa fashia kashi sari tuanjole aba kwa nano konika ba yoreda mofemo aba katuanjole kaminshe ni ayoreda bala feni police kasoja aganye mkose inyeme tuanjole ana shinyo wadromo na mene wakama esha eko.
Items including 6 bottles of foreign liquor, 6 bottles of beer, 6 buckets of paint, and an amount of 10,000 Ghana cedis were presented to the chief and people of Gamashi. Next on the Ga calendar is the Yam Festival, which begins in the latter part of June.
It's that time of your evening to talk some business. My name is Esther Adu Ohumewu. The mining sector contributes 14% to government's domestic revenue. Despite its contribution to the economy, the Deputy Minister for Lands and Natural Resources, Mr. Kwabena Minta-Akando, says investments made into the sector have not translated into higher output over the years.
Experts say the extent of natural resources in Ghana can potentially reduce poverty and transform the economy if the resources are properly harnessed. Despite its potential, the country is not deriving the needed revenue from most minerals mined. The total investments into the mining and mineral sector from 1980 to 2015 was $16 billion. This figure, according to the president of the Ghana Chamber of Mines, does not reflect the value and the volume of mineral exports over the years, with global decline in commodity prices being a major factor.
A number of resource-rich African countries have been hard hit by the slump in commodity prices, particularly Zambia, Nigeria, South Africa, Angola, and Gabon. All of these have struggled, manifesting in rather large balance of payment deficits and, to some extent, domestic fiscal imbalances. According to the president of the African Development Bank, Dr. Adesina Akinwumi, African resource countries need to establish other sources of income that run counter to the cycle of commodity prices.
The Deputy Minister for Lands and Natural Resources, Mr. Kwabena Minta-Akando, said although irregular power supply has been a bane to the industry, government is improving the country's energy mix to boost power supply to all industries, including the mineral sector.
The mining sector in Ghana relies primarily on national grid, but high dependence on hydropower and low reserve margins have made the power system vulnerable. Ghana's recent capacity shortages, exacerbated by low levels of water in our hydro dams and the West Africa Gas Pipeline Company's gas supply challenges, have resulted in load management, which has impacted on power supply to the mines.
He called on traditional authorities to build consensus with the mining firms with the view to maximizing the benefits expected to accrue from the mines in their area.
The National Investment Bank, NIB, is to pay a dividend amounting to 6 pesos per share. The bank declared profits after tax of 120 million Ghana cedis, out of which 11 million Ghana cedis will go into the payment of dividend to shareholders. On the broader outlook, the bank is expected to continue pursuing its aggressive strategies to increase its market share and strengthen its balance sheet.
The first Ghana Savings and Loans is a subsidiary of NIB with an equity of 98.98%. National Investment Bank is one of the banks which has been in existence for over 50 years with more than 40 branches across the country. The bank provides general banking services and funding for other entities such as Pambra Salt Company, Metro Mass, among others. It offers innovative products and services to satisfy the needs of customers.
To fully brief its shareholders about the bank's performance last year, the bank organized an annual general meeting to review its operations. Within the period, the bank recorded a profit before tax of 144.65 million Ghana cedis and a profit after tax of 120.11 million Ghana cedis for 2015 compared with 79.4 million in 2014. The bank registered 14.45% growth in its total assets from 2,319.6 million in 2014 to 2,654.7 million in 2015. Shareholders' funds increased from 486.82 million in 2014 to 543.18 million in 2015, representing a progression of 11.75%. The stated capital of the bank currently stands at 70 million Ghana cedis. The board chairman of the bank, Togbe Afede, said the global economy in 2015 performed below expectation as a result and met projections, which stood at 2.4 as against the estimated 2.6%. In expectation, he hopes that commodity prices will gain modest recovery from the downturn to encourage investment to stimulate global growth.
The bank in 2016 has continued and will continue to pursue its aggressive strategic plan, which aims at expanding its service delivery network in order to increase market share and maximize shareholder value. This will be approached with due consideration to the prevailing economic conditions. We aim to improve upon the bank's competitiveness in order to position it to be able to take advantage of the expected rebound in economic activity.
The chief operating officer of the bank, Mr. John Kweku Asamoah, said the bank has generated a growth strategy to generate more income. According to him, the requirement by the Bank of Ghana that banks operate within a seed capital of $100 million or more is not insurmountable. NIB hopes to be listed on the stock exchange by improving on its competitiveness to take advantage of the expected rebound in economic activities. It also aims at reaching out to people who do not keep their monies or assets with the bank. Thus, it has opened 11 new branches across the country.
The Royal Bank Foundation, a subsidiary of Royal Bank, has constructed 19 boreholes in selected communities in the Upper East region. At a joint commission at Katwi Asana in the Katsina Nankana West District, the board chairman of Royal Bank, Dr. Kofi Kodriasapong, told the gathering that the bank has a goal of reaching out to deprived communities.
The Royal Bank, which is a member of the Global Haulage Company, a renowned private transport entity, set up the Royal Bank Foundation with the objective of reaching out to needy communities in the area of health, water and sanitation, education, culture and sports. Apart from its banking services, the bank has embarked on a number of flagship charity ventures in needy communities. Although the Royal Bank operates mainly in the urban areas, it has extended its corporate social responsibility to areas where it is currently not operating. So far, 19 communities in the Upper East region have benefited from the gesture. Beneficiary communities include Namolu, Ghana, Pinda, Kusingu, Sakom, and Timonde. The chairman of the Royal Bank Foundation, Reverend Fostel Kofi, said the bank believes in inclusion and is therefore committed to providing amenities to improve the well-being of the poor and marginalized in society.
This foundation is fashioned according to the dream of the founder of the bank to ensure that it reaches out to the needy communities in the areas that I've just outlined, that is health, sanitation, water, support for education, support for culture and sports.
The Royal Bank Foundation is also on record to have ensured the construction of 18 similar boreholes yet to be commissioned in the Upper West region. The board chairman of the bank, Dr. Kofi Kodriasapong, said the focus is to construct over 60 boreholes by close of the year.
We operate mainly in the southern sector, but we think that those who benefit from our business span across the country, not necessarily in Accra, where we have the majority of our branches, but people do business across the country. So therefore, whatever we have to give out as corporate social responsibility can be extended to every part of the country, and that is precisely what we are doing. Well, for that reason, we are in the Upper East region. We don't have any branch here. We are not even in the Northern region yet. We'll be there very soon. But we do believe that since the company exists for the benefit of the entire country and beyond, if we deliver corporate social responsibility here, it is in order.
On behalf of the community, the chief of Katui, Pe Motola Aikode Zangwe Atoge, expressed gratitude and entreated other entities to emulate the Royal Bank's example. Board members and management of the bank, led by Dr. Adamu Idrisu, had earlier paid a courtesy call on the chief of Katui.
On the interbank markets, the cedi lost 2 pesos to the pound sterling and a peso to the euro. You are most welcome to the insurance news brought to you by SIC Live. Munich RE is to cut 1,800 jobs at Ergo, its German primary insurance business, in a bid to restore the loss-making unit to profitability. The cuts, which account for about 13% of Ergo's workforce, are part of a plan to trim the cost base by 280 million euros by 2020. And that was business. Thanks for watching.
Good evening, and we're most grateful to have you join us on the health segment of the news brought to you by FPAC. My name is Evans Echampon. The June 3 disaster brought to the fore the need for Ghana to have a functional burn center. The disaster exposed the weakness in some state institutions, including the burn center at the Kolibu Teaching Hospital, Ghana, which at the time of the incident did not have a properly functioning intensive care unit. 1 year on, in remembrance of the dead, the reconstructive plastic surgery and the burn center of the Kolibu Teaching Hospital has held a lecture to educate the public on how to manage burns.
Burns constitute a major public health problem with over 300,000 cases recorded per year across the globe. Burns leave some victims disfigured or disabled for the rest of their lives. Burns remain high due to deficiencies in advocacy, policy development, research and data management. Following the June 3rd disaster, about 19 people were rushed to the Reconstructive Plastic Surgery and Burn Center of the Kolibu Teaching Hospital. Out of the 19, one person lost his life. The other 18 were treated and discharged. In an effort to prevent a recurrence of the unprecedented disaster that shook Ghana's foundation, the Reconstructive Plastic Surgery and Burn Center and the Fire Service have held a lecture to educate the public on fire safety measures. The director of the center, Dr. Opoku Wariampoma, expressed concern about the number of burns recorded at the hospital. The chief investigator of the Greater Accra Regional Ghana National Fire Service, Mr. Alexander Kwachi, encouraged institutions to make fire safety training a prime concern. he extended a word of caution that fire safety equipment are made readily available in homes and offices.
The hazard at your kitchen is your burner and your LP gas. These are basic hazards within the kitchen. Now, if you also have any heating element, for us, if anything that will bring about heat, once the heat gets to a certain temperature that could ignite the slightest thing, it will cause fire.
A visiting lecturer from the University of Glasgow, Dr. Nicholas Watson, urged government to enforce legislative measures to ensure that interventions like smoke detectors and sprinkler systems are mandatory requirements when structures are being built.
Every old house is supposed to have a smoke alarm. So by law, you are supposed to have a smoke alarm. So even in the time that I have been working in Burns, in the latter stages of our social and material development in Britain, it never happened. And no one changed that until 96 people died.
Over 95% of all burn deaths occur in low-middle-income countries.
That's it for the segment brought to you by F.
Let's update ourselves from happenings in the world of sports. I'm Theophilus Sampa. The Minister for Youth and Sports, Nilante Vanderpoel, has thrown his weight behind the upcoming Unity football match by ex-Black Stars captain Stephen Appiah. The endorsement came in a meeting between Appiah and the Minister.
Paid a courtesy call on the Minister for Youth and Sports, Nilante Vanderpoel, at his office in Accra. He was accompanied by ex-Black Stars players like Kingston and Ibrahim Tanko, the General Secretary of the PFAG, Anthony Bafo, and officials from Primeval Media, Larry Opariotu and Jeffrey Asari. Appiah's mission was to officially invite the Minister for the upcoming Unity match.
We all know that this year is an election year and there's slightly tension in the country. Sitting here today is Ghana who has made me who I am today. So I always want to give something back to the motherland. So we're going to use football to preach. We're not going to sit down to let something happen before we say that we should have done A, B, C. We're using football to let Ghanaians know that we have only one Ghana. And whoever is going to be elected to be the president is a Ghanaian.
The CEO of Primeval Media, Larry Opariotu, outlined some plans in place for the event.
The players will be arriving on the 7th of June. All of them, the likes of the Soul Campbell, Alex Song, we have Edgar Davis, Dwight York, we have Jermaine Defoe, Hasebank, we do have JJ Okocha, we have Michael Essien, we have Sule Muntari, of course Stephen Appiah will be playing, we have Laya Kingston as well, Ibrahim Tanko there as well, and these galaxy of stars will be in Ghana. So, Honorable, they will be arriving on the 7th by KLM, and they will straight away check into the Tank Palace. Then the next day, that's on the 8th, they fly to Kumasi to visit Otunfo. Then in the evening, we play against Kumasi Asante Kotoko. We fly back to Accra on the 9th. There is also a program lineup for the players. They want to have what we call the deprived kit to engage.
Former high-ranking FIFA officials Sepp Blatter, Jerome Valcke and Marcus Gardner are reported to have awarded themselves pay rise and bonuses worth $80 million over 5 years. Football's Gardner Buddy revealed the contract of ex-President Blatter, ex-Secretary General Valcke and former Finance Director Gardner a day after Swiss police raid. Its lawyers said there was evidence that the trio made a coordinated effort to enrich themselves between 2011 and 2015. Suspected of criminal mismanagement of FIFA money, Blatter and Valcke were banned for 6 and 12 years respectively by the governing body Ethics Committee in February. Both denied wrongdoing. FIFA has been in turmoil since May 2015 when a US investigation exposed widespread corruption at the top of the organization. Well, that's all for sports.